I was mentioning a while ago how climate change can actually help contribute or even exacerbate conflict situations. Tell us first, how does it actually affect or even contribute to conflict situations or exacerbate conflict situations?
Sure. I would like also to say that it's my honor to be here on behalf of the humanitarian country team of the Philippines, which is the international interagency humanitarian leadership body under the leadership of the humanitarian coordinator, Mr. Gustavo Gonzalez. And on this World Humanitarian Day, we would like to remind the world that we are caught in the climate emergency. You know, time is running out for millions of the world's most vulnerable people. And these are the people who contribute at least to the global climate emergency, but are hit the hardest. We know that today humanitarian actions are needed for more than 235 people who are in need of assistance, and over 82 million people have been forced to flee their homes partially because of the climate change. We also know that 957 million people across 93 countries do not have enough to eat. Now, we also know that climate change disproportionately affects women and poor. For instance, 80% of those who have lost their homes due to climate-related disasters are women. And one of the greatest injustices is that the cost of climate change is borne primarily by those who did the least to cause the climate change. Mm-hmm. Also know that it's estimated that climate change may push additional 132 million people into poverty by 2030. The climate crisis jeopardizes the benefits and progress that have already been made in addressing the poverty and gender inequalities.
Let's talk about that now, David. When you talk about addressing, or at least the humanitarian response in relation to climate change, the IPCC report is sort of a confluence of years and years of research into how climate change has affected different parts of the world, most vulnerable countries, of course, included. But in terms of climate action and climate response, humanitarian response, I should say, how has that changed through the years? Because through that response, maybe people can also get a bigger, a clearer picture of what climate change actually is for people who have been affected by it. David.
Thank you. Well, in the case of Philippines, we know that the Philippines is extremely vulnerable to the effects of climate change for two main reasons. One is geography and also the development. And we see that there are three main risks to the people of the Philippines due to the climate change. One is the rising sea levels. And it is estimated that around 150 million people currently live in the areas which are set to be submerged by 2050. And unfortunately, around 70% of these people are in Southeast Asia, including the Philippines. We know that a lot of people in the Philippines live on the coast, where the elevation is mostly low, thus the risk of being submerged is very high. The second one is impact on marine life. Being an island nation, the Philippines relies heavily on fish and for food. But unfortunately, climate change is already having a negative effect on marine life. Rising sea temperatures and ocean acidification from pollution, including the coral reefs. And the result is that the fish will have less to feed, which means that the less fish are caught, driving up prices and leaving thousands hungry. And lastly, extreme weather. We know that the Philippines is hit by a number of strong typhoons, and the intensity of those typhoons has been increasing in the recent years, with significant damage to agriculture, infrastructure, and livelihoods of people. And we need to address all these three issues, and there are different ways that we're addressing these issues. For instance, in the Philippines, the international community, under the leadership of the United Nations, is piloting a new way, is exploring a new way to minimize the impact of the natural disasters, natural hazards, and avoiding large-scale crises before it happens. We are now implementing under the leadership of the United Nations, we're implementing anticipatory action project. This anticipatory action project means that actions are taken before a crisis or emergency happens.
And speaking of that, David, I'm sorry, but we're running out of time. Speaking of actions that can be taken prior to a crisis, how can countries think beyond just disasters and catastrophic events when they think about climate change? Because vulnerable countries like the Philippines seem to think of it in the more traditional way, so to speak, that this is just all about disasters. This is just all about catastrophic events, not really thinking that this is also, and this should be, about actions prior to these events, David.
Well, we think that CARE thinks that addressing climate crisis should lead to climate justice. So it's about the future in which the poorest and most marginalized have improved their well-being significantly and also can enjoy their human rights due to the increased resilience to climate change, increased equality, but also limiting the rise in global temperature. So in order to achieve this vision, we work on three interconnected pathways. One is increasing capacities and assets for people of all genders. Then the second one is progress through the policies and actions by power holders in the global north and global south, and also strengthening collective voices and action of civil society, including social movements.
Right, we're going to have to leave it at that. David Gashashvili, their country director of CARE. Again, we appreciate you joining us today. Continue to take care and you keep safe.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Take care.